And Mostafa Hegazy, welcome. Mm-hmm. Thank you for joining me.
Thank you, Christiane.
There was a clear promise to restore Egypt to democracy. Mm-hmm. So when can you tell us that there will be new elections? Will Mr. Mansour run? Will General al-Sisi run? When will the whole constitutional process that was promised on July 3rd and 4th and in the days thereafter actually start to be visible?
The parliamentary elections would be early 2014.
And early then means what? January, February?
I think January would be, it's the start of the process, not necessarily that we have the parliament by that time. It's the end of the referendum would be probably the end of December. So the referendum on the constitution. Once we have the constitution in place, we will be calling for parliamentary elections in about a week or so. And then we start the process of parliamentary elections for another 2 months or more. So we're looking at the end of parliamentary elections probably towards the end of March, early April.
So do you envision presidential elections next summer?
Yeah, pretty much.
It obviously can't come as much surprise to you that there has been an enormous amount of anxiety and criticism and worry now in Egypt, even amongst the people who supported you, even those who said this is what the people want, that we want to go into the streets and we want an end to the Muslim Brotherhood and that kind of extremism. Now they're saying that the very things that they criticize the Muslim Brotherhood about, you are doing. The repression, the arrest of journalists, the harassment of human rights activists. People are saying it is worse than the bad old days.
I think this is what I call a pretty linear thinking, which is having some manifestations.
Would you say it's a wrong thinking?
Yeah, I believe so. It's not very precise.
I mean, I have colleagues who are going to jail. Journalists, human rights activists.
Yeah, but let's be precise about what kind of situation we're having now, which is, first of all, we have an administration in place that has been, in its entirety, alienated by the Mubarak regime or the Muslim Brotherhood regime. And we came with the will of the people to be more of the custodians of making sure that what happened at the Mubarak time and the Morsi time not to be repeated again. But we have to know that we
have... They say it is being repeated and it's worse. They say look at the state of emergency that's being extended.
Yeah, that's a good point. I lived in Los Angeles at a time that we had a situation for, you know, a police brutality that ended up in riots in the streets, and we had emergency laws in Los Angeles by the time, and we had the National Guards in the street. You wouldn't say that because of this incident.
Are you comparing LA to what's happening in Egypt right now?
In a way, that what happened in a week could have been extended in Cairo for about a month or so. But what I'm trying to say, the emergency laws got its own reasons, because we had to have a curfew in place in order to maintain the security of our people and security of other people like the journalists and others. So if you have this, I would say you're mandated to have a curfew. You have to make sure that you have to have emergency law in place. So it's not for the sake of the emergency law itself. As I said, sometimes desperate times requires desperate measures, like what happened in Los Angeles, that what happened in Cairo.
Right, I see the comparison you're trying to make, but you're talking about putting journalists in jail as a, I think I hear you say, for their own security.
This is very serious what's happening now. I haven't been
and
saying
I,
this.
I would like to have an answer as to why the very people who supported you are now worried and see the system turning against them. Liberals, journalists, human rights activists, people who say, we may not have been able to speak freely under the Muslim Brotherhood, and we can't speak freely now under this new interim government.
I think, first of all, this is too general a statement, and I think this statement
does not
apply.
The United States is saying that, Europe is saying that.
No, no, it does not apply to all of the, I would say, the incidents, because we've been talking to U.S. officials, we've been talking to European officials, and we've been very close to the incidents that are happening, even with some journalists, and I think some of those happened because there has been violations of the law, probably by the curfew times or so. And it's not like you're trying, or maybe it's been portrayed in a certain way, like, you know, this is like, you know, a tyranny reestablishing itself. This is not the case.
People are saying that.
No, this is not the case. The case is that we have a certain security situation that might dictate having a curfew, for instance, as one of the instruments in order to maintain security. If you have someone in the streets violating...
It's an inability to criticize.
No, that's not the case.
Well,
no, that's not the case in any way. Not the case, because you have not only journalists, you have people from the opposition, which is not only the opposition, people who are trying to put Egypt on pause, who are the Muslim Brotherhoods. Those people are now criticizing the government. They're having marches in the streets. They're talking to journalists, to foreign officials, and no one is in any way is chasing them or detaining them. So it's not like...
Mr. Hegazy.
Let's not make it like the habit of a government is trying to detain
journalists.
Mr. Hegazy,
those very people are being swept up and put in jail. the Muslim Brotherhood people who you just referred to are in jail. All the people we used to talk to are in jail.
No, this is too general. This is too general because you have some of their own historical leaders who's been inciting violence.
The spokespeople are in jail. The people I used to call and talk to are in jail.
The people who's been instigating violence, those are the people in jail. We are very keen to be the custodians of freedom of expressions, freedom of speech, and freedom of protesting in any ways, provided there is no violence in it. And that's exactly the case that might cause some people to be, in a way, legally prosecuted because of instigating violence or practicing violence.
So, where does it get you as a nation to once again ban the Muslim Brotherhood? And I ask you because after July 3rd, there was a lot of talk from your own interim leaders that we actually want the Muslim Brotherhood to be part of the new democracy. You know, you went bent over backwards to say you wanted them in the system. And yet, the facts on the ground show precisely the opposite of what you said, that they have systematically been arrested, that their press has been closed down. Obviously, the president has been arrested. All his top ministers and people have been arrested. As I say, the top spokespeople have been arrested. Is the Muslim Brotherhood banned?
No, they have to be legalized. No one would be banned in Egypt unless the law bans his own activity. Sometimes maybe I would say in a slogan way of saying it that they have been a banned organization. The Muslim Brotherhood as an organization has never been a legal organization. It has been only a name, a slogan that's called the MBs, but all the time, as you said, they've been running as independents under this kind of theme or under this kind of slogan.
Where is President Morsi?
He's in custody.
Where is he?
In a safe place.
Has he had access to lawyers?
I think he does.
Do you know for sure? Because his family say he doesn't.
No, he does.
Will it be a military trial?
No.
When will
the trial
happen?
It's a civil trial. It's happening as we speak. It's not a trial. We have the process.
In secret?
Not the trial.
No, that's what I'm saying. When is the trial?
The trial will happen after the investigation with him is finished.
When do you think that might happen?
It's in the hand of the Egyptian judicial system.
And it'll be a public trial?
Yeah.
People look back at this amazing thing that happened in Tahrir Square in, you know, spring of 2011. And they wonder, has that all been lost? And how can you harness again? How can Egypt recover the promise of that kind of desire for freedom and reform and democracy?
There is a huge difference between the time that you're talking about, which is the time of Morsi, and now. You can find that you have a certain faction of Egyptians that are not happy with the will of the people that has been manifested on the 30th of June, which is the MBs and some of their allies. But this is not the kind of division that might be portrayed in your statement, that there is a division of over 50-50 of the people that are not happy. We have a certain group of people that they have all the respect, they have all the rights to be contained and included in the Egyptian society and the Egyptian future, but it's not this kind of massive division as you mentioned. It's a bulk, or Egyptians are unified. When I say Egyptians, it's the mainstream Egyptians, not the extremists. You have extremists in any society, but the mainstream Egypt is unified more than any time before. It's unified for, I would say, a civil Egypt, for Egypt that is for all Egyptians. It's for a constitution written for all Egyptians, by all Egyptians. You can see that in the Committee of the 50, which would, in a way, reflect that there is no division in the sense that you're mentioning. You have in the Committee of the 100 that by the time of the MBs was writing the constitution, it's either Islamists, MBs, or their allies. Now in the Committee of the 50, you have all Egypt there. You have Muslims, you have Christians, you have the church, you have Al-Azhar, you have poets, you have intellectuals, you have people, Egyptians living abroad, like Dr. Magdi Yacoub and others. You have prominent Egyptian figures. This is the real Egypt, which is now unified. So you don't have this kind of division that has been, in a way, portrayed in your statement. What we know that we have some or a certain faction which is not, I would say, aligned with Egyptians' view to the future. And we would like them, as much as they can, to join the Egyptian caravan to the future, because it's for the good of everyone. It's for the good of them, it's for our good. It's the other way around that sometimes when people talk to us about inclusiveness, I think it's for the MBs and their allies to start thinking of including us as Egyptians, because they have been excluding the whole of the, I would say, the body of the Egyptian masses and the Egyptian people. They have been calling Egyptians infidels for the past year or so, in practical ways. So you cannot just ask this huge mass of Egyptians to not only, I would say, be unified. They are unified as Tahrir Square. It's the ones on the extremes who would like to be out of the square, per se, with this kind of analogy that you just made, that it's about time for them to be in the square again. We're calling upon them. I'm making efforts as much as I can for them to give themselves the chance and to stay away from the escalating rhetoric and this kind of, you know, head-on collision type of discourse that they're having all the time. It's not like anyone is against them. I've been telling them that even by the time that they were ruling Egypt. Enough with the conspiracy theory. I'm talking to them. Enough with the conspiracy theory. You have a golden opportunity to have an Egypt for all Egyptians. Just join Egyptians. You're not a better breed than Egyptians. You've been discriminating against Egyptians for a year or so. You cannot discriminate against them now with their will manifested in that huge numbers in the streets. It's about time for you to join Egyptians, not the other way around. It's a golden opportunity that they can capture. They can seize the moment, as Richard Nixon has said before, and it's a moment to seize.
Mr. Hegazy, thank you very much for joining me.
Thank you.